For the last year and a half, an outbreak of the deadly Ebola virus has racked the Democratic Republic of Congo. More than 3,000 people have fallen sick, with more than 2,000 dead. And much of DRC is also at war. At the outbreak's epicenter, attacks against medical teams have left the vital response at a near standstill. In partnership with the Global Health Reporting Center, special correspondent Monica Villamizar has the first of two stories on this crisis.
The outbreak zone is also a war zone, which makes fighting this disease an increasingly difficult battle. Stepping off in Butembo, our first stop is the medical tent. Hand washing, foot washing, and a temperature check.
C'est bien.
C'est bien.
Merci.
I'm fine, but a sudden fever could mean Ebola, a disease that typically kills more than half of its victims. The first Ebola cases in North Kivu province, in northeastern Democratic Republic of Congo, were reported in the summer of 2018. North Kivu is densely populated and shares heavily trafficked border routes with Uganda and Rwanda. The people of DRC have suffered more than two decades of war, with at least hundreds of thousands dead and millions made refugees in their own country. In North Kivu, the fighting is chaotic. Ethnic groups fighting for power and resources and Islamist rebels based in neighboring Uganda. Civilians are frequent targets. Ever Ketz led the UN peacekeeping force in North Kivu.
There is clearly a security crisis with attacks from armed groups and the need to protect civilians against those. Secondly, there is now the Ebola crisis, which is also a huge challenge from a public health point of view.
At first, the medical teams fighting Ebola were simply caught in the crossfire, but now they are targets. This past year, the World Health Organization counts nearly 400 attacks on treatment units and health workers. The week we arrive, violent street protests force a lockdown at the UN base that is the nerve center of the Ebola response. So for now, we're stuck. And it's not just us. The doctors, the medical detectives, and the vaccination teams are trapped here as well.
The cafeteria has been turned into a makeshift office for all the medical professionals you see here. They're on lockdown, and that is a problem, they say, because if they can't go out, they can't monitor who has Ebola and who may be spreading it to other people.
The next day, we head north.
We're hearing that the protesters are armed and increasingly hostile towards the UN and health workers. So we're being evacuated from Butembo. We're going to Beni, a city that's also on lockdown, and we're being escorted by the police.
The city of Beni, with a population of 250,000, has been at the center of the outbreak. The number of cases is down from its peak in the spring, but a deteriorating security situation makes it very hard to stamp out the final viral flames. And just as in Butembo, there are growing protests. This protest leader says they're angry that UN troops are not doing more to stop the violence and says the foreign doctors must leave.
Even if the white doctors left, it wouldn't be a problem. We have our own black Congolese doctors who will stop this outbreak.
Making matters worse, few people in Congo trust the official word of the government or the press. Many get their news through a toxic mix of distortion, rumor, and political agitation, much on social media. Some misleading.
Westerners want to kill Africans and sell vaccines for a disease that can be cured. Congolese people are too naive.
And some just flat out false.
At this moment and during last night, helicopters flew low over the city of Lubero to inject its population with Ebola.
You need 140 characters or something. And that's all you need to spread some of the rumors and perceptions that we're certainly tracking.
Dr. Heidi Larson runs the Vaccine Confidence Project, which studies public attitudes about vaccines all over the world. She says the same trouble played out during the largest Ebola outbreak ever in West Africa 5 years ago. Almost 30,000 people were infected in Guinea, Sierra Leone, and Liberia. Economies and health systems nearly collapsed.
One of the biggest things we know from rumor spread is that they thrive in times of uncertainty. they thrive in times where people need an answer, are eager for an answer.
In DRC, the anti-Ebola campaign and the foreign money behind it are seen by many as a way for the powerful to line their pockets. The previous health minister was arrested this summer and charged with stealing funds. This man works in an orphanage. He came here to get the Ebola vaccination, to protect himself, yes, but also to set an example.
Orphans overheard that the vaccine is killing people. I want to be a model and encourage them.
But not everyone is convinced. Heading to the UN compound, we hear that the gates are blocked by protesters.
So moving here is extremely difficult. It can only be done with an armed escort. We're trying to talk to the spokesperson to see what's going on.
Hi, this is Monica.
Hi, Monica.
We're like with a bunch of policemen and a pickup truck, and we're following in a blue Jeep with tinted windows. Great. Good. We're coming towards you. If there is like shots or whatever, please open the gate.
This march is a response to a massacre by Islamist rebels just days earlier, where at least 8 people were killed. Dr. Margaret Harris is with the World Health Organization.
So what we're seeing now at the moment is an outpouring of anger because we have a large peacekeeper contingent. And as far as the people are concerned, they're saying, why are we still suffering?
How is this affecting the medical response to Ebola?
This is paralyzing all the work that we would normally do to trace all the people who might be infected, to vaccinate all the people who might be at risk, to get the people at risk to hospital and make sure they get care. All those things we can't do right now.
But it doesn't mean a complete standstill.
We've built up huge local teams, and one of the good things about this response is that we have built up the ability to do this work in the local population. And I do know that local community agents are doing their very best to keep this work going on.
And critical work it is. One of the 5 people who died the week we arrived was a motorcycle taxi driver.
And it's close contact with people because you're in the motorcycle, then you have to hug someone if you're going to fall off the motorcycle.
And he also wasn't identified until he died. So that means he was very symptomatic for a lot of days. So you get more and more and more infectious as you approach death.
It's a race against time to find those contacts, to check on them and vaccinate if they're willing. And this is just one case of many.
Some people were telling us that they want foreign health workers to leave and they can manage the Ebola crisis on their own. Do you think that's true?
I do understand why people are angry. It's more frustration. Every minute gives the virus a chance to get ahead and harm the very people who are out there demonstrating.
Just days after I spoke with Dr. Harris, rebels killed 4 medical workers in a pair of ambushes. Nearly all WHO staff, including the doctors, were evacuated. The other major foreign medical groups pulled staff out as well. Predictably, the virus seized that opening. Vaccinations and quick treatment had nearly ended the outbreak. But in early December, the number of confirmed cases started to rise again. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Monica Villamizar in Beni, DRC.
So important to tell these stories. That is the first of 2 from Monica Villamizar.